Welcome to ElectronLine. Our next example is similar to the previous example. We are not just calculating the volume, but we're multiplying the volume element by some function, in this case, x squared plus y squared plus z squared, which is really the equation of a sphere. So what we're doing here is we're multiplying the equation of a sphere times the volume element and then doing a triple integral. It's probably not a good idea to do this in Cartesian coordinates, so we're going to transform that into spherical coordinates. Remember, we have a sphere of radius 5 units. The origin is the center of the sphere. The equation of the radius of the sphere is equal to the square root of x squared plus y squared plus z squared, which means that we can actually change this to rho, which is the unit, or I should say the measure in the radial direction. And so this can then be written as rho squared, quantity squared, times the volume element in spherical coordinates. So this is now going to become the triple integral of the radial distance to the fourth power times the volume element, which is rho squared times the sine of phi times the d rho, d theta, d phi. And for rho, we're going to integrate from 0 to, let's see here, that would be to 5. For theta, we're going to integrate from 0 to 2 pi. And for phi, we're going to integrate from 0 to pi over 2. Those are fairly standard since we have a spherical shape. So this becomes equal to rho to the 6th. When we integrate that with d rho, this becomes equal to the double integral over theta and over phi. And so rho squared times rho to the 4th is rho to the 6th. Integrated becomes rho to the 7th over 7 times the sine of phi, d theta, d phi. And rho is going to be integrated from 0 to 5. So that's quite an integral, because when we plug in the lower limit, we get nothing. But when we plug in the upper limit, we get, that would be 5 to the 7th power. So we have the double integral. And let me, since it's a constant, let me just write outside the integral sign. So this becomes 5 to the 7th power divided by 7 with the double integral. And what we have remaining is the sine of phi, d theta, d phi. Now the next integral, we're going to integrate over the angle theta from 0 to 2 pi. And so this becomes equal to 5 to the 7th power divided by 7 times the single integral over phi times theta evaluated from 0 to 2 pi. And that leaves us with the sine of phi d phi. And when we plug in the limits, of course, 0, you get nothing. Getting 2 pi, that becomes equal to 2 pi times 5 to the 7th power divided by 7. And then the single integral of the sine of phi d phi evaluated from 0 to pi over 2 is left. And that one, of course, is the familiar one since we're dealing with spheres. When we integrate that, we get 2 pi times 5 to the 7th power divided by 7. And this becomes the negative cosine of phi evaluated from 0 to pi over 2. And of course, when we plug in the upper limit, we get, not pi over 2. We're going to integrate from 0 to pi. I've got this all wrong. We have to go over 180 degrees. So this would be from 0 to pi, not pi over 2. So when we plug in the upper limit, we get negative 1, but the negative becomes a positive 1. Plug in the lower limit, we get minus and minus 1. So this becomes equal to 2. 2 times that, which gives us 4 pi. So this is equal to 4 pi times 5 to the 7th power divided by 7. Now, can we simplify that? Well, let's see here. 5 to the 3rd power is 125. 5 to the 4th power is 625. 5 to the 5th power is 3,125. So this can be written as 4 pi times 3,125 times 5 to the 2nd power, because this is 5 to the 5th power, times 5 to the 2nd power, that's 5 to the 7th power, divided by 7. Now here, this is 25 times 4 is 100. 100 times this gives us 312,500 pi divided by 7. And this is the eventual result of integrating, doing the triple integral of this function times dv over that spherical shape with radius equal to 5. And that's how it's done.